Okay, the final item of business this evening is a debate on motion 10068 in the name of Bob Dorris on tackling child poverty. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, but I invite members wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Bob Dorris to open the debate around about 7 minutes. Mr. Dorris.
Presiding officer, I want to begin by thanking all those who have supported my motion on tackling child poverty in Scotland. My motion outlines the deeply damaging impact of UK welfare policy on low-income families in Scotland. UK government policies impacting some of Scotland's poorest families. Appalling policies such as the benefits cap and the two-child limit, not forgetting its notorious rape clause. It is estimated that those UK policies have pushed 20,000 Scottish children into poverty in the last year, and that this year 25,000 children in Scotland are affected. We all have a responsibility to do all we can to reduce and ultimately eradicate child poverty in all parties and at all levels of government. The Scottish Government action to tackle child poverty, including our £25 per week Scottish child payment, has lifted 90,000 children out of poverty. However, the UK's two-child limit directly undermines that progress. As Citizens Advice Scotland have put it, the two-child limit is actively working against welcome action to meet the Scottish child poverty targets, such as the introduction of the Scottish child payment and the mitigation of other UK social security cuts by driving up poverty rates for families and groups identified as at greater risk of poverty. Glasgow North West Citizens Advice stand in solidarity with those impacted families every single day. And I want to thank them for all they do, and for sharing the voice of lived experience with me in advance of this debate, some of which I now wish to share with you. They supported a lone parent to four children, aged between 14 and 4 months. They needed help with energy debt and support to progress a child maintenance claim. No one plans to be in financial difficulty. The parent found herself in financial difficulty when she separated from her husband and became reliant upon Universal Credit and was only entitled to support for two of her four children. Presiding officer, imagine a benefit system, a UK benefit system, that financially punishes a lone parent for a marital breakdown. Yeah. A financial penalty that targets and removes money intended to support children in need. And these cases are not uncommon. Glasgow North West Citizens Advice also assisted another lone parent to four children. They were aged from 12 years old to 3 years old. The CAB assisted in applying for health-related benefits for two of the children who had severe additional support needs. The parent found himself in financial difficulty when his wife died and gave up well-paid work to care for his children. In claiming Universal Credit, he was only entitled to support for two of his four children. Imagine experiencing such a bereavement and facing severe financial hardship under a UK benefit system that simply dismisses the financial needs to support two of your children. That is the current UK benefit system. This is the reality of the two-child limit in practice. It is the reality for almost 4,000 people in Glasgow, reportedly the worst hit council in the country by the two-child limit. 54% of the households in receipt of Universal Credit or child tax credits in Glasgow were not receiving financial support for at least one child. It's the... Yes?
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful for Mr. Dorris taking the mention. Would you like to address the issue of my constituent who is disabled and is poor and is needing the money, who put in an application to Social Security Scotland back in January of this year and is still waiting for the first inquiry to be acknowledged by the department? Surely he would acknowledge Social Security Scotland are failing the people who are disabled in Scotland, and would he apologise for that?
Mr. Dorris, I can give you the time back.
Mr. Balfour, I've come to respect much of your comments in this chamber, but that was an appalling contribution. Of course, Social Security Scotland must do all it can in a dignified way to reach out to disabled people and to do our best, and we will do that. But to make that representation here this evening, when your party are plunging families into poverty by design, is just disgraceful, Mr. Balfour. It's the reality for 20,000 children across the country. My constituency of Mary Ellen Springburn is amongst the worst affected. The two-child limit causes disproportionate harm to low-income families and women survivors of domestic abuse or assault. I don't pretend to know what that's like. On that front, let's be clear, to the Labour Party, you can't make a rape clause fairer. There's nothing fair about rape. I'm not surprised that the Conservatives didn't sign my motion condemning the current UK government for its punitive benefits regime, which impacts on the most vulnerable families. A motion which also notes calls for the Scottish Government to increase its representations to the UK Government to reverse the benefits cap and the two-child limit. However, I am genuinely deeply disappointed that none of my Labour colleagues in the Scottish Parliament backed my motion. A motion that takes a stand against the current UK Conservative Government. Labour failed to do that. Just let that sink in. We are all well aware that Sir Keir Starmer and the UK Labour Party have flipped on this issue, and that the Labour Party would now retain the deeply damaging and unjust UK benefits regime. But I know, and I do know, Presiding Officer, there are Labour colleagues in this place who are disgusted as I am about the benefits cap, as disgusted as I am about the two-child limit, and as disgusted as I am about the rape clause. This evening's debate is an opportunity for MSPs and all parties to raise their voice in solidarity against a UK benefits regime which by design, chooses not to support our most vulnerable. A discredited benefits regime now set to be adopted by Labour should they take power. So I ask members to show solidarity, not with the SNP, rather join with us in solidarity with those families impacted by and driven into poverty. A UK benefits regime which undermines Scottish efforts to tackle child poverty. A UK benefits regime which willfully denies families adequate financial support for children and families living in poverty. Now, I look forward to the rest of this evening's debate and hope others across all parties will raise their voice in support of a benefit system that should show respect, dignity and fairness, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Doris. Given the nature of this evening's debate, I just remind the Chamber that comments should be made through the Chair throughout the course of the debate. I call firstly Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Paul Kay in around 4 minutes, Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm happy to be involved in this evening's debate. Social Security benefits is an incredibly important part of governance, and I feel often doesn't get enough airtime in this Parliament. Unfortunately, however, instead of dealing with the failings of his SNP government, and unfortunately not debating issues that we can change in this Parliament, and simply deflecting away attention from the woeful record of his government over the last 6 years on Social Security. Not a moment. We are 5 years on from devolution of Social Security, the setting up of a Social Security Scotland. We should be up and running by now. We should be seeing the fruits of a uniquely Scottish system of benefits that work for uniquely Scottish need. We had an opportunity of a lifetime, an opportunity that very few governments ever get, a blank slate, a clean piece of paper. But what did the SNP do with it? They have created a shambles here in Scotland.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr. Balfour for giving way, and he talked about deflection. I think the deflection in this debate has come tonight from Mr. Balfour in the fact that we are discussing child poverty and the unfair and cruel practices of the Conservative government. Social Security was always supposed to be a safety net, but that safety net has been removed with the benefit cap and the two-child policy. Does Mr. Balfour think that that safety net should be put back in place and that we should do our level best to help children across this nation who are in poverty?
Jeremy Balfour, and I can give Jeremy Balfour and give you the time back.
Can I thank the member for his speech in regard to that intervention? I think that we have seen from the UK government during the pandemic and since the pandemic, a government that has put that safety net in and is there, and more to the point, is working, unlike the system his government has introduced. Because 5 years on, the DWP are still administrating key benefits in Scotland that should be devolved, including severe disability allowance, which the Scottish Government handed back because we could not deal with it. 5 years on, we have seen a 350% increase in the number of complaints being made against Social Security Scotland, each one representing an individual and a family that's had to fight harder for the support and access that they require. And to crown it all, there is a small detail of a £1.3 billion black hole in the finances that will open up in 2028.
Bob Doris.
And I thank Mr Balfour for giving way. I think he's making interesting and flawed contributions to a different debate. It's not the debate we're here this evening to have, but the debate we are here to have this evening is whether or not it's fair or just for 20,000 children across Scotland, 4,000 children in the city of Glasgow that I represent, where the UK Tory government by design will not meet their basic needs because of the two-child cap. Does Mr Balfour agree with that?
Could I please encourage interventions to be a little bit briefer? Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. No, I don't agree with him. And I think what we should be debating here in this Parliament is the powers that we have and are simply not using due to the incompetence of his government. The SNP have managed to so grossly mismanage the rollout over the next 5 years, they will have to come up with a shortfall that is roughly the equivalent of the entire GDP of the Solomon Islands. They will have a choice in the next few years: cut Social Security, or cut education, or cut health. That's the choice they have to make because of their incompetence. That will leave more people in my area and across Scotland in poverty. Presiding Officer, we have to ask, how did we get here? We can be certain that the situation is not helped by the lack of accountability and reporting that we see from Social Security Scotland. The Social Justice and Social Security Committee got a letter during recess. David Wallace proudly announces that they are unable to report on the times taken between the submission of relevant documents and the decision being made on a benefits application. With that lack of oversight, it's no small wonder that we are seeing so many complaints. Do not be mistaken, Deputy Presiding Officer. This is a mess, and it's a wonder that the member has the nerve to bring forward his motion to this Parliament. Passing comment on performances
Mr Balfour, could you resume your seat? Point of order, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sitting here listening because I'm not participating in the debate this afternoon, but Bob Doris's motion is about tackling child poverty, not attacking Scotland's social security system, which is doing a great job. So I'm just curious about this issue that he's speaking about today and how it relates to the motion.
Thank you, Ms Harper, for your point of order. There does need to be relevance. I think Mr Balfour has been linking the comments he's been making to the motion in relation to poverty. I'm satisfied that he is within then standing orders. Jeremy Balfour, if you could be winding up now.
I'm grateful, and I will seek to wind up by concluding in regard to this. Maybe we need to focus more on our own responsibilities within the Social Security system to make sure that those, for whatever reason, and wherever they live in poverty, I'm afraid I think my time was gone. But this is the thing. They do not want the Scottish Government to focus on their shameful record. They want to blame everybody else, whether it's the UK Government, whether it's other parties that challenge them, whether it's individuals that have the strength to stand up and say, this is not working for me. They want to throw mud at others rather than clean up themselves and clean up Social Security Scotland so those that who are in poverty can get the money.
You need to
My
conclude.
Advice to the government would be to get your own house in order. Then you might have some credibility to speak. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Balfour. I could also remind the Chamber that the Minister responding to this debate will be responding remotely, and therefore interventions may be sought remotely as well, which will be indicated on the screens. I call Paul O'Kane to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Again, around 4 minutes, Mr. O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank Bob Doris for bringing the debate to the Chamber this evening, because there are few issues as pressing and as important as tackling child poverty. And it should be the focus of far more of our time in this chamber and far more of our collective energies in working on the solutions to tackle it in all its root causes and all its facets. Because the life chances of our young people are crucial to how we thrive as a society and as a world. So it's clear to me that we need changes of approach in order to lift more children out of poverty, both at a UK and a Scottish level. I am proud that the last UK Labour government lifted 2 million children and pensioners out of poverty, and 200,000 children in Scotland alone. We did this through fundamental reform of the social contract, introducing the national minimum wage, introducing tax credits, and revitalising support for families with children across the UK. And the next Labour government will focus on doing the same. Growing our economy, spreading wealth to all parts of this country, and fixing the economic carnage unleashed by the Tories. Delivering a new deal for working people, strengthening workers' rights, ending zero-hours contracts, and delivering a proper living wage, ensuring that everyone is paid enough to live on without having to solely rely on benefits to supplement poverty wages. I would like to make some progress. Fundamentally reforming the universal credit system and introducing a child poverty strategy that will ensure driving down child poverty runs through every aspect and every policy area of government and delivers a proper safety net for those who need it. And ensuring that people can pay their bills, particularly their energy bill, and not fall into a debilitating cycle of debt. And I will come on to speak about debt in more detail and the crucial work done by organisations such as ABBA Lower in this regard. And I'll give way to Kevin Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr. O'Kane for giving way. He talks a great deal about what a future Labour government may do. I wonder if he could comment on Sir Keir Starmer's statement that he wants to make the two-child benefit cap fairer, the rape clause fairer. Can I ask Mr. O'Kane how what he thinks can be done to make that fairer?
Paul O'Kane. Because I don't Paul think O'Kane. The rape clause Paul could O'Kane. Be fair.
Mr. Stewart will have heard me refer to the fundamental reform of universal credit that's required. We need to fundamentally change that policy because it doesn't work. The social security system does not work. It needs to be changed. 40% of claimants are in work. That's why we need a new deal for working people. We need better wages. We need a national minimum wage that is a real living wage that will lift people out of poverty. And we need to crucially get people back into work. I will give way in a moment if Mr. Doris allows me to just make a little more progress. Deputy Presiding Officer, in 2017, this Parliament unanimously backed the Child Poverty Act, which set legally binding targets to reduce the number of children experiencing the effects of poverty by 2030. But we know that in that last decade, 40,000 more children have been pushed into poverty in Scotland. 39% of those children from ethnic minorities are now living in relative poverty, and the percentage of babies has gone from 27% to 34%. And Mr. Doris's party have been in government, so I'll give way to him if he's got something to say, perhaps, in that regard.
Bob Doris.
Well, I thank Mr. Keane for giving way. The nub of this debate is, will any future government, Labour or Tory, will they abolish the two-child limit, abolish the rape clause, abolish the benefits cap that is pushing 4,000 children in Glasgow into poverty and 20,000 children across Scotland into poverty? A straight answer to that is something my constituents deserve to know and the people of Scotland deserve to know.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Fundamental reform. I talk about fundamental reform of credit because that's what I believe in. But you cannot make unfunded spending commitments because you then, working people will pay the price. But let me remind Mr. Doris, perhaps, of the SNP's position on the abolition of the two-child cap. Shirley-Ann Somerville said, it's not our policy.
Mr. O'Kane, could you resume your seat? Mr. O'Kane has taken interventions from both Mr. Stewart and Mr. Doris. I think they owe him the courtesy then to listen to the response and the remainder of his speech. Mr. O'Kane, and you should be beginning to wind up shortly.
She said it's not our policy to alleviate the two-child cap. So there's perhaps a straight answer for Mr. Doris's constituents. Presiding Officer, I did have more to say on debt because Aberlour, in their briefing for this debate, which I thought was an excellent briefing, pointed to that vicious cycle of debt that is pushing people into more and more poverty. And we need to take action. All of us in this chamber, as MSPs, need to take action to support our local authorities and our national institutions to be able to alleviate that debt and ensure that people can get out of poverty. But to draw to a close, Presiding Officer, I will begin where I started. Lifting children out of poverty must be our relentless focus, but tinkering at the edges won't do. We need to fundamentally change how we approach our economy, how we approach work, how we approach our social security system to ensure that, as they have in the past, these systems once again improve the life chances of all of our people. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Michael Marra, around 4 minutes, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to Bob Doris for bringing this important debate to the Chamber. It follows on well from last week's programme for Government, where Hamza Yousaf reiterated his mission as First Minister to tackle poverty and protect people from harm. Right now, child poverty is way too high. In Scotland and across the UK, though Scotland is the only part of the UK with statutory income targets on tackling child poverty. Recent statistics show that 22.6% of children in Scotland live in poverty. I'd like to make progress, thanks. In Labour-run Wales, that figure is 24.4%, and under the Tories, more than 30% of children in England live in poverty. Social Security, of course, has an important role to play in terms of tackling child poverty, and thankfully, this Parliament now has powers over Social Security, albeit they are limited. The Scottish Government has introduced 13 new benefits, 7 of which are only available here in Scotland. This includes the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, worth £25 per week per eligible child, and a supplement payment for unpaid carers. Backed by an investment of over £400 million, the SNP's bold Scottish Child Payment is estimated to lift around 50,000 children out of relative poverty this year. However, in the past 5 years, the Scottish Government has also had to spend more than £700 million mitigating the effects of cruel Tory policies like the bedroom tax. With that money, we could instead increase the Scottish Child Payment by over £7.50 per child per week. So the Scottish Government's missions are being held back by having to protect people from the worst of Westminster's policies. I would, however, argue the Scottish Child Payment is also a mitigation, since it protects people from the UK Government's poor minimum wage, well below what is required for people to live, and their cuts to universal credit of £20 per week. Change is coming, says Labour, so let's consider their track record. When they were in the Better Together gang with the Tories, Labour told Scotland to vote no. They said they would keep Scotland in the EU and that Labour would one day become the UK government and build a fairer society. We are now 9 years on from that referendum, and what has happened? We've had 4 more Tory prime ministers and Scotland was dragged out of the EU against our will. With a UK election on the horizon, Labour's offer to the people is nothing but a continuation of cruel Tory policies like the benefit cap and the 2-child limit. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's measures to tackle poverty are bold and ambitious, and they are lifting children out of poverty. However, it is clear that whoever it is in Downing Street, some things will never change. Scotland will have to put up with abhorrent policies and mitigate where we can. That is no way to run a country. If anything, this is a prime example of why Scotland must become independent by getting rid of the broken Westminster system and equipping this Parliament with the full powers it needs. We can eradicate poverty once and for all. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Michael Marra to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Around 4 minutes, Mr.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. And I do appreciate Bob Doris's personal commitment to this issue, and I do share his moral affront at child poverty, and that the shape of our economy in Scotland determines that 1/4 of children in our country grow up in grinding daily poverty. It is an affront to every single one of us. And they are not saved by social mobility, which has collapsed in Scotland in recent years, where access to higher education is still significantly more difficult for those young people from the poorest backgrounds, particularly to universities and courses which determine the highest earnings and to the professions. And if we are to address this, we have to build an economy that ensures greater equality instead of accelerating divisions. But the truth is, Presiding Officer, we have had no transformative governments of the left in the last 13 years. Instead, we've had middle-class populism and right-wing ideologues. And the Truss government's economic vandalism should be no greater example about the consequences when you make accelerated, unfunded spending commitments and crash the economy and working people pay across this country. And the public services and benefit payments we require rely upon it. So we do have a responsibility as political parties to maintain public support for tax and social investment. And the SNP frontbench in recent days has been keen to twist the words of Anna Sarwar when he said that the devolution era has spent its time preoccupied with how to spend money rather than how to generate it. Now, to me, Presiding Officer, that is a statement of the obvious and partly is a function of the legal responsibilities that we have that have now expanded, yes, but it is also a government with a narrow view of political economy. The outcomes for a huge proportion of the population will always be determined by what the government allocates rather than what people can achieve. We do have a sclerotic economy in this country, with many of the challenges that predated the government in this place that are still unaddressed, let alone the headwinds of economic change, of net zero, and even some of the opportunities that might present. Mr. Doris's speech was in part firmly aimed at Labour, and I can understand why he takes that approach, and I'm happy to address that head on. The scourge of child poverty that holds back this country is a malignant legacy of collective moral failure, and it will be a defining purpose of any Labour government, just as it has always been a defining purpose of any Labour government. A Labour government will work to lift children out of poverty. It always has. The last Labour government lifted 2 million children and pensioners out of poverty, 200,000 of those children in Scotland. Please, Mr. Doris.
Bob Doris.
Mr. Mara, I really appreciate you giving way for your comments regarding myself, but I'm deeply frustrated that this motion, at its heart, seeks to do something very simple, to put pressure on a UK Conservative government who are wed to the rape clause and two-child limit, and ask Labour to join the SNP to defend the 4,000 children in Glasgow and 20,000 children across Scotland that suffer because of that. Can you do that this afternoon?
Through the chair, please, Michael Mara.
I can say, Presiding Officer, that I associate myself entirely with the contents of the motion. Certainly, there's very little in there at all that I disagree with. The challenge that is faced by any incoming Chancellor of the Exchequer in this country is that we have to have the money to be able to pay the bills. And I have to say, when Mr. Doris wants to talk about the hypothetical government that might face us in the future, line one, page one of his own manifesto is to cut £13 billion out of our yearly budget in Scotland. Yep. Goodness only knows how we can address, and that is the fact presented in the GERS figures commissioned by this. If you're talking about the hypothetical situations going to be faced, then you have to have responsibility for your own policies, Mr. Doris, in that regard
as well. Please.
Because it's incredibly difficult to see how those issues can be addressed under the proposals brought forward. No, thank you, Mr. Stewart. But the fact that child poverty has soared again since Labour left office in Holyrood and Westminster is a bitter reminder to all of us of how important a government focused on a better economy and a fairer country is. It does tell us the regrettable truth, far too often neglected, that progress must be rewon every day. Must be rewon in every year, that there is no final battle for social justice, and we can and we have retreated as a country in recent years. And frankly, Presiding Officer, I would have no part of any political party that does not take this issue incredibly seriously. We must base our approach on the allocation of resources that we have, not those that we might wish to have. The horror of the ideological fantasies of the Tory government have crashed us out of Europe. They've crashed our economy and they've crashed our public finances on the rocks of economic reality. There is nothing in this motion that is wrong. There is only one way of making progress.
Thank you. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Marie McNair. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to express my deep thanks to Bob Doris for securing this debate. and to all the third sector organisations that have provided such wise and helpful briefings to us. This is clearly an emotive subject, and it ought to be. There is no more heartbreaking sight than a hungry child, a homeless child, a child excluded from opportunities to play, to learn, to explore the wonders of a world so new to them. But it is not enough for us to stand and weep, or to shout at each other and point fingers. We can and must look with clear-eyed honesty at what we know about child poverty, its causes, however hard some of those might be to hear, and its solutions. One thing we do know is that most children are not in poverty alone. They are part of families. As the Cabinet Secretary reminded us last week, women's poverty and children's poverty are inextricably linked. Women make up the vast majority of single parents. Barriers to employment limit their family income, and they overwhelmingly act as poverty managers for their families, going without basic meals so their children can eat. Growing up in a family that experiences poverty can have lifelong effects on children's health, mental and physical, on their relationships, education, livelihoods and well-being. Recent research by UCL describes the relationship between poverty and adverse childhood experiences. The trauma of those experiences can and often do stay with a child for the rest of their life and pass down to generations beyond. And children are part of communities in which poverty is shared and commonplace. Bob Doris refers to those in Glasgow. And in my region of the Northeast, too, we have areas of very high multiple deprivation. Those include parts of Dundee, Buckie, Peterhead, Fraserburgh and Arbroath, and it includes Torrey in Aberdeen, where health professionals have testified to the vital importance of St Vitick's Park in alleviating the heartbreaking effects of poverty and exclusion. For those children, yesterday's council decision to lease that park, their only green space for development, was a terrible blow. I don't forget either that the standard indices aren't so efficient in identifying rural poverty. Children in Aberdeenshire and Angus know poverty too, often in particularly difficult ways, and they need our attention and our commitment. So what do we know about solutions? I think there are three broad categories. First, are policies that directly benefit children by increasing their family's income and reducing its costs. Those include, of course, the Scottish Child Payment, access to affordable childcare, and effective help for families in debt and those who are struggling to cope. They include free school meals, free bus travel, rent controls. And they must include help for both families and unaccompanied children seeking asylum. Second, are policies that improve the physical and social infrastructure of children's lives, education, housing, transport and environment, and also economy and finance, as others have already alluded to. We have tools to test how far these are really working to reduce child poverty. It's essential that we use these at the right time, that we pay attention to their findings and make changes where change is most needed. And finally, there are those measures to change the political and legal environment in which children grow up. The incorporation of the UNCRC, the Scottish Human Rights Bill, mainstreaming of human rights and equalities. These have the potential to be transformative, so that children in poverty are not simply objects of charity, but subjects of dignity, of robust and enforceable rights. Of course, we face barriers that are not of our own making. Of Westminster hostility, of the limits of devolution, of lowest common denominator politics. So I implore all members here of Westminster parties to do all they can to influence those parties' policies, most urgently the cruel two-child limit and the bitter benefit cap. For Scotland's children deserve and need not only compassion and care, but solidarity, justice and action.
Thank you. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury, up to 4 minutes. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate Bob Doris for securing this important members' debate on child poverty. Child poverty is holding back too many in Scotland, so we must do everything we can within our powers and resources to reverse that position. I welcome measures set out in the programme for government and its focus on tackling poverty. £405 million will be invested in the Scottish Child Payment this year, helping over 300,000 children across the country. We know this is a lifeline for many families, especially during the Westminster-imposed cost of living crisis. It is now paid at £25 a week for eligible children, and we need to seriously look at how it can be increased in future budgets. The expansion of universal free school meal provision for all pupils in primary 6 and 7 will also help many families with the cost of the school day. I've got quite a lot to cover. Will I get it back, Presiding Officer?
You can get a bit of time back, yes. Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to the member, and I agree with Maggie Chapman's remarks about the importance of free school meals. Would she agree it's been very disappointing that there's been a long delay now in P6 and P7s getting that rollout, and that has affected many vulnerable children because the Scottish Government have delayed it for a number of years? And can she explain why that delay has happened?
Marie McNair.
I thank the member for that intervention. You know the reasons why, obviously, the infrastructure isn't there and it will be soon. But I really thought you'd be standing up to actually tell us how you support the two-child policy, and it's a born
through
rate
the chair,
cost
please.
To defend that. It's now paid at £25 a week for eligible children, and we seriously need to look at how we increase in future budgets. Increasing eligibility for Best Start food payments will mean that around another 20,000 people will access it when the income thresholds are removed in February. But as always, the programme for government has to deal with the consequences of damaging Westminster decisions. Since 2017, the Tories' cruel two-child benefit cap has cost families in Scotland £341 million. And the Scottish Government's mitigation of cruel and incompetent UK government policies has made a real difference. Indeed, an estimated 90,000 children have been lifted out of poverty. The two-child policy and its rape clause deny children the basics and humiliates and traumatises women. It's no wonder the Scottish Association of Social Work describe it as inhumane. We recently witnessed a sad spectacle of one of the lapsed Corbynistas trying to airbrush it out of debate. But we won't allow that, especially not when debating child poverty. The rape clause is abhorrent, it is disgusting, it is cruel, and it's Labour policy. An extremely sad state of affairs and evidence that nothing much will change in the area of welfare policy if Labour replace the Tories. Labour have U-turned on so many previous pledges to reverse Tory policies. We previously had New Labour, but they're now behaving like the New Tories. They're now planning to keep universal credit, abandoning their previous pledge to scrap it, but they don't seem keen on the First Minister's call that Westminster should use its reserve powers and introduce an essentials guarantee to the value of universal credit. This is supported by the Trussell Trust and Joseph Rowntree Foundation. Universal credit is flawed, and its design is holding many families in poverty. The child charity Abelur has highlighted work by Professor Morag, trainer of Heriot Watt University, and this sets out the scale of the DWP direct benefit deductions from low-income households. More than half in receipt of universal credit have at least one deduction by the DWP from their monthly allowance to cover debts to public bodies. More than a quarter have multiple deductions from overall monthly income, and it was reduced on average by £80 to cover those debts. I back calls from Abelur for a moratorium on these deductions to help give struggling outcomes and give households a chance. And I hope that that call can get support across this Parliament. To conclude, the Resolution Foundation have said that this Westminster term of Parliament is on track to be by far the worst for living standards since the 1950s. This can't go on. There needs to be a more just and compassionate path taken. Given the abject failure to achieve this by all political parties who aspire to govern at Westminster, it is clear that only with the full powers of an independent Scotland will that path come to fruition. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call final speaker in the open debate, Faisal Chowdhury, around 4 minutes, Mr Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to thank Bob Dorris for bringing this important issue to the Chamber. Presiding Officer, tackling child poverty was outlined as the national mission of the Scottish Government. Yet, most recent figure shows one in four children in Scotland continue to live in poverty. Children who grew up in poverty will continue to experience far-reaching consequences of a childhood below the poverty line. For many children, growing up in poverty will impact on their physical and mental health and well-being. It will have an effect on their education and ability to learn and develop. It can significantly reduce their life opportunities and experiences. The Scottish Government needs to address this and ensure that support for children is available across all areas where poverty may have affected their lives. Children who grow up as part of minority groups such as disabled households, black and minority ethnic households, and also single parents' households are disproportionately affected by poverty. 39% of children from black or minority ethnic families live in poverty in Scotland. No, I wouldn't, because my colleagues have taken enough and I've got a lot to cover. A recent report by the CPG Poverty outlined that those from black and minority ethnic communities will also face even further poverty-related stigma than others. The Scottish Government approach to tackling child poverty must address this. Children born into impoverished area will eventually face significant hurdles in their life. In 2019, it was reported that a boy born in Muirhouse currently has life expectancy of 13 years less than of a boy born in neighbouring Cramond. This is still the reality for many children living in poverty, and we have yet to see any significant improvement from the Scottish Government. Inequality of access is also a major issue affecting children living in poverty. I've got a lot to go through. In several communities in the Lothian region, there are incredibly long waiting lists for council-run swimming lessons due to the demand of overreaching supply of swimming pool facilities and teachers. Private lessons are very expensive and are simply out of the budget of many lower-income families. This means that children across Scotland are losing out on vital water safety skills and opportunities to have fun and socialise with friends. Once again, it is the lower-income families who are losing out. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government must do more. When high levels of children in Scotland who have parents under the age of 25 live in poverty, the Government must do more to support young parents and ensure their welfare system does not fail them. It must do more to combat the disproportionate effect that poverty has on BAME and other minority groups. It must do more to achieve its national mission and eradicate child poverty. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chaudhry. I now invite Emma Roddick, the Minister, to respond to the debate. Minister, for around about 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Bob Doris for securing this debate and to those who've contributed. I think it's fair to say it's been a very passionate debate, and I can assure members that being virtual today has not prevented me from hearing all the things they've been yelling across the chamber. And of course, I'm speaking today as a government minister, but I know as an MSP that all of our caseloads are still full of people who are struggling with the impact of this cost of living crisis. Not only has it entrenched poverty for those already struggling, but people who never expected to be in dire financial straits are now begging us for help. And that's why it's right that tackling poverty and protecting people from that harm is one of three critical and interdependent missions for this government, alongside our focus on the economy and strengthening public services. Scotland's ambitious child poverty targets were unanimously agreed in the chamber in 2017, and this government continues to drive forward action needed to deliver a fairer future for the children of Scotland. Both last year and this, we have allocated almost £3 billion to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost of living crisis. Now, Mr. Balfour earlier claimed, quite incredibly in this debate on child poverty, that the UK social security system is functioning and Scotland's is not. Now, Scotland's child payment has lifted 50,000 children out of poverty, while welfare cuts from his party are keeping 30,000 in poverty. So I don't know what his definition of functioning is, because this is certainly having an impact, but it's not one that I want to see. I will take an intervention.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, the Minister. Would the Minister acknowledge that most of the benefits that here in Scotland are still being paid for and run for by DWP? So, in fact, it's DWP that are keeping money in people's pocket, not by Social Security Scotland.
Minister, then give the time back.
I would agree it's the DWP that's keeping children in poverty in Scotland. And I hope that what I heard there from Jeremy Balfour was a call for further benefits to be devolved to Scotland, where we can manage them more responsibly. Because sadly, if the UK government matched British government ambitions, we'd be in a very different place right now and having a very different conversation. And I say sadly because there's no clear route to me that I can see any UK government in the near future matching our ambitions. From trying to mitigate those harmful welfare reforms to watching as the UK fails to implement helpful measures like the Scottish Child Payment, we are fighting against the tide. Because in the last 5 years, the Scottish Government has spent £711 million mitigating the impact of Westminster welfare cuts alone. Now, the two-child limit alone is affecting 80,000 children in Scotland, and it's removed over £341 million from Scottish families since 2017. The latest statistics confirm the families of almost 2,600 children across the UK were forced to disclose details of rape in order to receive support for a third or subsequent child. So I really cannot get my head around the Scottish Labour position since we returned from summer recess following some visits from Keir Starmer, because I'm now hearing colleagues who've spent 2 years telling us to do what we're already doing, but do it faster and with more money, excusing and apparently adopting U-turns on welfare, on climate change and more from their leader in Westminster, who took an interest in getting Scottish Labour in line as soon as it looked like there might be some success in London. So it's clear that the UK Labour is now the party of continued austerity, of keeping the two-child cap, scrapping free school meals. The Labour Party has completely abandoned plans to even address child poverty, never mind eradicate it. Now, Mr. O'Kane's comment, repeated later by Michael Mara, about being unable to make unfunded commitments might carry more weight if his colleagues didn't show up every week demanding unfunded commitments. But I would also point out that we know exactly how many people are impacted by this. We know that this has cheated Scottish parents and bairns out of £341 million since its inception. It's not numbers that are missing here. It is political will and consistent principles from Labour. I'll give way to Mr. O'Kane.
Paul O'Kane.
The Minister said in her remarks that a future Labour government would do nothing to lift children out of poverty. But she agreed with me, however, that raising the national minimum wage to the level of a living wage, banning zero-hours contracts, rights for workers from day one, increased sick pay, a fundamental reform of universal credit and the entire UK benefit system would fundamentally lift children out of poverty. It would lift children out of poverty just as the previous Labour government lifted a million children out of poverty, 200,000 of which lived in Scotland.
Minister, and again, I can give you the time back.
I sincerely cannot get my head around Scottish Labour standing there and claiming that a Labour government would fundamentally change universal credit but fail to get rid of the most horrible and disgusting parts of it, like the two-child cap. Now, I do not believe that all of my Scottish Labour colleagues, many of whom I know share this drive to tackle child poverty, can be happy with their policies being overridden and shouted down in the media like this. And they truly have my sympathies for that, because that is exactly the sort of imbalance of where power lies and where it should lie that the SNP has been highlighting throughout our history. And if anything can demonstrate to unionist parties the need for Scotland to have the ability to make its own decisions about its own issues, it should surely be this bizarre and disgusting challenge from their London bosses. But I'll turn back now to what the SNP is doing. Modelling estimates that 90,000 fewer children will live in relative and absolute poverty this year as a result of this government's policies, with our poverty level 9 percentage points lower than it would have been otherwise. That includes an estimated 50,000 children who've been lifted out of relative poverty by the Scottish Child Payment. But we can't fall into the trap of simplifying not just the drivers of poverty, but the things that are keeping people trapped in poverty, stopping them from getting out of difficult cash flow situations. Scotland already has the most generous childcare offer anywhere in the UK, supporting families and helping to give children the best possible start in life. Our programme for government sets out ambitious commitments to delivering a significant expansion of targeted childcare provision, focused on tackling child poverty and supporting more parents to take up or sustain employment. And I know that the inquiry currently being led by the Social Justice Social Security Committee will provide real insight, the type of necessary lived experience input that Bob Doris described in his opening remarks. We're investing £752 million this year through our Affordable Housing Supply Programme and will introduce a housing bill to deliver a new deal for tenants. We're also making £108 million available for the delivery of employability services. We will continue to use all the levers at our disposal to promote fairer work practices across the labour market in Scotland. And of course, we recognise the wider, less tangible drivers of poverty. We know that poverty is generational, that it affects minority groups to a greater extent than others, and that it's cyclical. We know that opportunity is limited more for some than others, and that the cost of living, the cost of literally remaining alive, is different for different people. Maggie Chapman made this point well. Children are not in poverty alone, and tackling gender and disabled pay gaps and entrenched inequalities is necessary to tackle child poverty. Now, that's not as simple as launching a fund or creating a new payment. It needs societal change. But that is what we are attempting to lead in the Scottish Government, with work on an immediate priorities plan for disabled people, launching an anti-racism observatory that can provide an evidence base for making policy that is actively anti-racism, and incorporating international human rights treaties as far as possible within devolved competence into Scots law. Now, we know that there's hard work to do in overhauling attitudes as well as public sector policies, and that is the hard work we're committed to doing. The Scottish Government will continue to do everything within the scope of its powers and limited budget to tackle poverty and support those in greatest need, strengthening that support where we can. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting of Parliament.